Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Bryan Lynn.
And I'm Caty Weaver. This program is aimed at English learners. So we speak slowly, and we use words and phrases, especially written, for people learning English. Coming up on the show, a report from John Russell. We also hear the Health and Lifestyle Report from Anna Mateo and Joe Robbins. And we close the show with the lesson of the day. But now it's back to my co-host, Bryan Lynn.
A Taiwanese business is seeking to become the first foreign company to launch a rocket from Japan. The planned launch comes as Japan keeps on a path to invest $26 billion in its space agency over the next 10 years. The idea is to create a space hub for other nations in Asia. The private Taiwanese company is called T-Space. It was started in 2016 by current and former officials from the country's space agency. It has not yet completed a successful rocket launch. T-Space's most recent launch attempt came in 2022. The effort was in cooperation with Australian company AtSpace. The launch attempt failed because of a fuel-related issue. The rocket to be launched in Japan is a different design. There has been some opposition in Japan to the country's plans to contract with foreign businesses for space activities. But T-Space chairman Jensen Chen told Reuters he thinks the planned launch should make a very good case for Japan's government. Chen said his company was waiting on one last government approval before the rocket launch can be set. The launch will involve a sounding rocket that could happen by early 2025. A sounding rocket can fly to space but does not reach orbit. Some industry experts have suggested that China could oppose the launching of a Taiwanese rocket from Japan. China claims Taiwan as its own territory, but Chen said he had not yet heard any concerns from China. A representative from China's foreign ministry told Reuters it did not have detailed information about the planned rocket launch. In Japan, the government's cabinet office said free economic and research activities are guaranteed in Japan within the structure of the country's existing laws and regulations. T-Space is the only Taiwanese company seeking rocket launches in Japan. One of the company's other co-founders, Wu Jong-shin, is currently head of Taiwan's space agency. Agency officials had no comment on T-Space's plans and said all its launch services are carried out through government contracts. The company's launch plans have won support among some Japanese space businesses, especially in the rural town of Taiki. That is where T-Space's launch will take place. Space officials and industry experts say it is a good thing that Japan is inviting foreign companies to use its space services. Yuko Nakagawa is a ruling party lawmaker who represents Taiki and neighboring communities. She said she sees the T-Space project as a symbol of Taiwan-Japan friendship. She noted that the addition of more international businesses to the area can help create a large space complex to serve a number of nations. Japanese officials have said they want the country's private space industry to be worth more than $50 billion by the early 2030s. The space program could include up to 30 rocket launches a year. Reuters reported that Japan is negotiating a space technology agreement with the United States that could open the door for private American rocket launches in Japan. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Scientists now have an explanation for the mysterious remains of an ancient Egyptian woman who has her mouth open in what appears to be a scream. Scientists used a special computer-aided X-ray, or CT scan, of the woman's body. What they found suggested that the so-called screaming woman mummy may have died in pain and experienced a form of muscular hardening known as a cadaveric spasm. This rare kind of spasm happens at the moment of death. The examination found that the woman was about 48 years old when she died. Cairo University's Sahar Salim said she had lived with mild arthritis of the spine and had lost some teeth. Salim led the study that appeared recently in the publication Frontiers in Medicine. The woman's body was well preserved, although it had been embalmed 3,500 years ago. Embalmers used costly imported materials such as juniper oil and frankincense resin, Salim added. The ancient Egyptians considered preservation of the body after death important for securing a good existence in the afterlife. It was a custom to remove the internal organs during the mummification process. But the organ removals had not taken place with this woman. Salim said, in ancient Egypt, the embalmers took care of the dead body so it would look beautiful for the afterlife. She explained that embalmers were interested in closing the mouth of the dead. Embalmers kept the jaw in place by tying the jaw to the head. This prevented the normal jaw drop that occurs after death. But the embalmers were likely not careless with the so-called screaming woman. They used high-quality materials and gave her costly jewelry and a wig, Salim said. She added that this evidence opened the way to other explanations of the widely opened mouth. The woman may have died screaming from pain, and the muscles of the face may have become tense to preserve this appearance at the time of death due to cadaveric spasm, Salim explained. She said that the full history of the woman's death is unknown, adding the cause of her facial appearance cannot be known with certainty. Cadaveric spasm is a poorly understood condition. It is thought to happen after severe physical or emotional suffering. The contracted facial muscles become tense and unmoving immediately following death. Salim explained that unlike the stiffening of muscles and joints that happens after death, cadaveric spasm affects only one group of muscles, not the entire body. Asked whether the woman may have been embalmed while alive, Salim added, "I don't believe that this is possible." Salim was unable to find out how the woman died. The screaming woman was found in the ancient city of Thebes during a scientific search of the burial of a high-ranking official named Senmut in 1935. The mummy was inside a wooden coffin in a room beneath Senmut's family burial area. Her identity is unknown, but her costly jewelry shows her important position. She was likely a close family member to be buried and share the family's eternal resting place, Salim said. I'm John Russell.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Health and Lifestyle Report. A new study has found that the twice-yearly injections of a treatment for AIDS were 100% effective in preventing new HIV infections in women. The U.S. drug maker Gilead sells the drug treatment under the name Sunlenca. The drug is approved in the United States, Canada, Europe, and in other places, but only as a treatment for HIV. The researchers ended the study early because of the surprisingly good results. All the people in the study were then offered the injection, or shot, also known as lenacapavir. Tandega Nkosi helped run the Gilead research at the Desmond Tutu Health Foundation in Masafumalele, South Africa. She said the idea of a twice-a-year shot is quite revolutionary news.
About 5,300 young women and girls in South Africa and Uganda took part in the study. Researchers reported that none of the women injected with the treatment became infected with HIV. Among those given daily prevention pills, about 2% became infected with HIV from infected sex partners. Gilead said it is waiting for results of testing in men before seeking permission to use it as protection against HIV. The New England Journal of Medicine published the results on July 24th. Experts also discussed the study at an AIDS conference in Munich, Germany. Gilead paid for the study, and some of the researchers are company employees. There are other ways to prevent HIV infection. These include devices like condoms or drugs taken daily by mouth. However, regular use has been a problem in Africa. In the new study, only about 30% of people given Gilead's Truvada or Descovy HIV prevention pills actually took them. That percentage also dropped over time.
Nkosi said the twice-yearly injections give people a choice. She added that injections took away the stigma around taking pills to prevent HIV. As an HIV treatment, the drug costs more than $40,000 a year in the U.S. Health insurance companies pay part of the cost, and patients pay the balance. People working to stop the spread of AIDS are interested in the Sunlenca shots. but they are concerned that Gilead has not agreed on a lower price for those who need the shots the most. Gilead has a tool that could change the trajectory of the HIV epidemic, said Winnie Biyanyima. She is executive director of the Geneva-based UNAIDS. She said the UNAIDS agency urged Gilead to share Sunlinca's patent with a UN program. The program's goal is to let generic drug makers manufacture low-cost versions of drugs for poor countries.
Dr. Helen Bygrave of Doctors Without Borders said in a statement that the injections could reverse the epidemic if it is made available in the countries with the highest rate of new infections. She urged Gilead to publish a lower price for Sunlenca that all countries could pay. In other research presented at the AIDS conference, Andrew Hill of the University of Liverpool and others said the drug's price would go down. They estimated that once production of Sunlenca is expanded to treat 10 million people, the price would fall to about $40 per treatment. He said it was important for health officials to get Sunlenca as soon as possible. "This is about as close as you can get to an HIV vaccine," Hill said. Gilead said it would seek a voluntary licensing program. It said a small number of generic producers would be permitted to make the drug.
In a statement last month, Gilead said it was too early to say how much Sunlenca would cost in poorer countries. Dr. Jared Baton is a product development official with Gilead. He said the company was already talking to generic drug makers and understood how deeply important it is that we move at speed. Biyanyima said many groups need long-lasting protection from HIV infection. They include women and girls who are victims of violence, and homosexual men in countries where homosexuality is criminalized.
UNAIDS says that in 2022, 46% of new HIV infections in the world were in women and girls. In Africa, females are 3 times more likely to get HIV than males, the UN group said. Recently, UNAIDS released a report on the state of the HIV epidemic. It said that fewer people were infected with HIV in 2023 than at any time since the late 1980s.
The UN says HIV infects about 1.3 million people every year and kills more than 600,000. Mainly in Africa. While much progress has been made in Africa, HIV infections are rising in Eastern Europe, Latin America, and the Middle East. And that's the Health and Lifestyle Report. I'm Anna Mateo.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
Now, Anna Mateo joins me for a chat about this week's report. Great to have you on the show, Anna.
Hello, Caty. Thanks for inviting me.
You and Jill reported about a study of twice-yearly injections of medicine to prevent HIV infection. The finding of the study is a pretty major advance in efforts to fight HIV/AIDS, I would think.
That's right. This study found that the drug Sunlenca, injected twice a year, was 100% effective in blocking HIV infections in women. This twice-yearly shot was so effective that researchers stopped the study to give everyone in it the shot.
There are other ways to prevent HIV infection, such as drugs taken daily by mouth. However, researchers stated that this twice-yearly shot is more effective than a daily pill. Why is that?
Regular use of daily pills has been a problem in Africa. In the new study, only about 30% of people given Gilead's Truvada or Descovy HIV prevention pills actually took them. And that percentage drops over time. One expert explained that the twice-yearly injections give people a choice. Also, the infrequent injections took away the stigma or shame around taking pills to prevent HIV.
Interesting. Thanks, Anna, for a great report and chat.
Thanks for having me. I really enjoyed talking about this topic.
That music means it's time for the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. My name is Andrew Smith, and I'm joined by Dr. Jill Robbins. Hi, Jill.
Hi, Andrew.
Our lesson is based on our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Anna introducing herself.
Hello, my name is Anna Mateo.
Today's lesson is based on Lesson 30 of Level 2 of the series. It's a special episode.
Yes, indeed. It's special because it is the final episode of the series. And it gives Anna and her coworkers a chance to dream about the future.
That's right. Every end is also a new beginning. So listen carefully to what Anna and her co-workers dream of doing. That means what they hope for the future.
And listen for the ing form of the verb after the two words dream of.
The episode begins when Anna and Ashley meet, and they each share what they have dreamed of doing.
Anna, where are you going in such a hurry?
Oh, hi, Ashley. The nurse's office. Today, I get the results from my blood test.
I'm sure you're fine. Don't worry.
You know, I used to dream of being a nurse. It is such an honorable career. Is there something you've dreamed of doing?
Sure. I would love to be a dog trainer. Actually, I've taught my dog Dublin lots of tricks.
Well, I'm off to the nurse. Bye.
Bye, Anna.
Bye, Dublin.
When we say, I'm off to, that is an informal way of telling someone where we are going. Anna is off to the nurse's office. After she gets there, the nurse gives Anna some advice. She tells Anna that life is short and that it's important to do something you love every day.
I think the older you get, the shorter life seems.
That's true. And maybe the idea that life is short is one reason people have bucket lists.
A bucket is an open container that can hold about 15 to 20 liters of material. For example, you put water in a bucket to help you wash a car or clean a floor.
But a bucket list is a list of the big things, the big dreams you hope to do during your life. Anna asks Jonathan about his bucket list.
Okay, Anna, say something and I'll check your sound level.
Testing. 1, 2, 3. Testing. Jonathan, I've been wondering something. What's at the top of your bucket list?
That's easy. I'd love to win the World Karaoke Contest.
This is so strange. I just saw on Twitter that they are having auditions in DC this weekend.
Are you serious? Can you read the story by yourself?
Sure, absolutely.
Thanks.
You go.
Anna is helping Jonathan do something he's dreamed of. He has dreamed of winning a big karaoke contest.
And he's not the only person she helps. Listen.
Penelope, I was wondering if you still dream of being a dancer.
Only every day.
Well, guess what? A famous dancer is having a flash mob around the corner. Hundreds of people are dancing together.
No way.
Way. If you leave right now, you can join them. Bye.
A flash mob is a dance that happens like a surprise, with many people dancing together in a public place.
Near the end of lesson 30, Ms. Weaver notices that Anna's coworkers have left the building. Anna suggests to her that there is something going around.
When we say there's something going around, we are usually talking about an illness like the flu or a cold.
But that's not what Anna really means. Listen to find out.
Anna, what's going on? Where is everybody?
I don't know. Maybe something is going around the office.
You mean germs? Anna, you better use some of this hand cleaner. You don't want to get sick too.
Right. Okay, thanks. Not germs. Dreams, Miss Weaver. Dreams.
What'd you say, Anna?
Nothing. Nothing.
Anna is helping her coworkers follow their dreams. Listeners, what are some of your dreams? What do you dream of doing? Are your dreams realistic and feasible? Or are they far-fetched?
Far-fetched means something is very unlikely or almost impossible to happen. But feasible means it's something that you can really do.
And remember, even difficult things can be feasible.
So, listeners, write to us at learningenglish@voanews.com. And let us know what you dream of doing. What's on your bucket list? Does your list include learning to speak English well?
I bet it does. To finish today's lesson, we'll hear Professor Bott talk about following your dreams. Thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith. Here's Professor Bott.
We hope you have enjoyed Level 2 of Let's Learn English. Everyone is following their dreams, big and small. What are your dreams? Our dream is for you to keep learning English. Thanks for watching.
That's all the time we have for today's show, but join us again tomorrow for another VOA Learning English program. Thanks for listening. I'm Caty Weaver.
And I'm Bryan Lynn.